And today we'll be having Dr. Ellie Lansey and soon to be Dr. Isroel Mandel give the presentation. For those of you who read the newsletter last month, you may have noticed as well that we had a highlight of Riverside Research joining the Center for Metamaterials. It's a NSF-sponsored collaborative center that combines work from industry, academia, and other organizations, government organizations, to advance research in the metamaterials. Both Ellie and Isroel both came out of the Center for Metamaterials program up at CCNY here in New York City. So with that, I'll go ahead and turn it over to them.
Thank you, Jeff. I am Ellie Lansey. Isroel will be speaking in the second half of this talk. We'll be speaking about advancing scientific research in metamaterials, some work that's ongoing here at our New York site. So what are metamaterials? Before we get any further, so metamaterials are materials with unique and extraordinary optical or acoustic properties, where these unique properties are primarily due to their structure rather than their inherent material properties. So for example, if you were to take a piece of gold and pattern it a certain way, and take a piece of copper and pattern it the same way, and a piece of silver and pattern it the same way, the thing that drives the unique effect of the metamaterial will be the pattern rather than the choice, rather than, strictly speaking, the choice of gold, silver, or copper, although they do play some role. Generally speaking, these are sub-wavelength structures. These things are smaller than the wavelength that you're typically interested in. And they're very often periodic. So you'll have things like, if you look on the bottom right, I'll get back to that in a second, this is a periodic tiling of Coca-Cola cans for an acoustic metamaterial. So some examples of metamaterials. On the top left, metamaterials do exist in nature. This is a blue morpho butterfly with a very vivid, bright and vivid blue color that arises primarily due to its structure. There's an inset of a micrograph of the structure of the wing, which you can see isn't actually blue. But when you have this tiled pattern, it gives rise to this bright and vivid blue. And there's actually a paper published very recently that shows that the color changes in a chameleon are also due to a very similar structure, where they're able to change their pattern in a way that gives rise to different colors. On the bottom left is one of the sort of standard split ring resonator microwave metamaterials. This is a man-made one. These demonstrate negative index of refraction, where light, or in this case, microwave radiation, when it enters this material, bends the wrong way than what you would expect for a traditional material. You can do all sorts of neat things with metamaterials. One example that people like referring to is cloaking. If you look on the top right, this is a simulation of a structure. That little green dot in the middle is a cylinder. Surrounding it, there's a fine black line, and everything between the cylinder and the black line is a metamaterial. Light is incident from the left-hand side, passes into the metamaterial that surrounds the cylinder, and it passes through to the other side unperturbed without the cylinder casting a shadow. This effectively cloaks the cylinder. Now, these things are very sensitive to angle and sensitive to frequency, so it's not quite, you know, at the level of Harry Potter yet, but, you know, that is something that people are trying to do. The bottom right, this is a Coke can acoustic metamaterial. You can see the speakers on the top of that picture. Here you have a periodic array of Coca-Cola cans, and this structure was designed for hyperlensing, where you can utilize a negative index property to give cause the sound, in this case, to bend the wrong way. What all of these share is by designing and choosing the right structure, you have a huge amount of control over the wave's properties as it interacts with the material. There are tons of applications from telecom to sensing, lensing, cloaking, solar energy, sensors, and we'll go through two examples later in the talk of applications for metamaterials. So an illustration of the fact that it's the structure that drives these unique effects rather than the material, here this is a micrograph, just a microscope picture of a gold-coated chip. Everything you see here is gold. The only difference between the gold and the green gold and the pink gold and the reddish-brown gold on the right is the pattern that these things are patterned in. These are all, if you look on the bottom right, this is an FEM image of what these structures are. It's two L-shaped structures interspersed. And the difference between the green, the pink, and the red is basically the periodicity, the shape, slightly different properties in terms of the pattern in each one. But everything you see here is gold. And the difference in the optical response in the color is due to the fact that each one has a slightly different unit cell and periodicity structure. So just a brief word about how these metamaterials are fabricated. At microwave frequencies, radio frequencies, it's pretty straightforward. You can basically print them out. You can use standard circuit board lithography techniques. You can see the length scale of the image on the bottom left. There's a ruler there. You can see it. You can touch it with your hands. You can put it together. On the other hand, when you move to optical frequencies, the length scales, optical frequencies of shorter wavelengths, the length scales of these structures get much smaller. You can see you need an SEM to take a picture of them, not a camera and a ruler. The scales are on the orders of tens or hundreds of nanometers. And to manufacture them, you need a clean room facility. Oftentimes, you need something like e-beam lithography. That's the image on the top right. The rule generally is the smaller the structure, the bigger the machine you need to make it, and also the more expensive it is to make. So again, these tiny structures on the bottom right, you need something that takes up a whole room to make it, and it costs many thousands of dollars an hour to run. To make the microwave frequency metamaterials, you can just print them out. We're going to be spending the rest of this talk discussing a particular class of metamaterials, which are photon sorting metamaterials, or maybe even metasurfaces. These are structures where you can split incident radiation or light of different qualities into different regions. So in this picture here, this is just a schematic. You have metal and you have a periodic array of holes. And the different holes are tuned to absorb, say, the purple light goes into the purple hole and the green light goes into the green hole. Now, the applications of this are many. You can use this to have enhanced sensing applications where you can have hyperspectral imaging, where you have one pixel that can absorb a broad range of frequencies. You can use it for solar energy, where you absorb different portions of the solar spectrum in different regions of a structure. You can do, and Isroel will be speaking about this later, polarization sensing. You can do remote chemical detection, 3D imaging. There are many, many applications for this sort of structure. We'll be focusing on two different sorts of photon sorting structures. One is photon band sorting, where different colors or different frequencies go into different places. And then polarization sorting, where different polarizations interact with different portions of the chip. So I'm going to begin with the band sorting structure. This is a design that we came up with. Here you have a periodic array of two holes per unit cell, a big hole and a small hole. This is a microwave structure, so the length scales are in millimeters. These cavities are filled with a microwave-absorbing material. The idea behind this was we wanted to show that you could selectively channel and concentrate light of different frequencies, or in this case, radiation of different frequencies, into different portions of the chip and absorb it entirely within those regions. This is a picture of the fabricated device. In practice, you can never build an infinite structure, so this is a finite structure. The black are the holes filled with a microwave-absorbing elastomer. Now, this is a plot of measured reflection. This shows that there is this is reflection off the structure, and you can see two distinct dips in reflection at around 8 gigahertz and around 9.1 gigahertz. We've overlaid simulated with experimental results. And as you can see, there are two places where almost all of the incident light is absorbed. And this is actually between 93 and 96% of incident light is absorbed in the measures in the fabricated structure. In simulation, we've been able to get it closer to 99% absorbed. Furthermore, you can't see this from this picture, but at the 8 gigahertz frequency, only 8 gigahertz light radiation went into one of the holes. And at the 9.1 gigahertz, that frequency radiation went into the other hole, with up to 95 to 99% of the incident radiation going into the correct hole. So we wanted to see this in measurements. So we went and we set up a probe, a near-field probe. It's difficult to actually measure the fields within the cavity. So we set up a near-field probe shown on top left. It's basically just an antenna that we raster scanned over the surface of the metamaterial. It's excited with the horn antenna on the top, and we translate the probe around, measuring the near field of the incident electric field above the metasurface. This is a plot of the measured photon sorting. So you have here, this is false color. These are microwave frequencies. The 8 gigahertz light was incident over the larger hole, and the 9.1 gigahertz was incident over the smaller hole. And as you can see, the red light, the red field is very strongly concentrated just above the aperture that concentrates that light. And the blue was very strongly concentrated over the light, over the aperture that concentrates that light. There are some vertical stripes there, which are an experimental artifact because the incident field actually scatters off of the measuring antenna. But this again, this sort of structure has many applications. Once you can control where light of different bands are going, you have control to do whatever you want with it at that point. You can use it for a broadband frequency selective surface. You can use it to concentrate and absorb light for sensors, for solar energy, or many other applications. So I'm going to now turn it over to Isroel Mandel, who's going to speak about another sort of photon sorting.
Thank you, Dr. Lansey. So he talked about frequency photon sorting, where, again, light of different colors or frequencies were sorted into different regions. I'll be talking about metamaterials that sort light of different polarization. So first, what is polarization? So some of you may be familiar with it in terms of, like, sunglasses. Everyone's sort of polarized sunglasses. So polarization is, if you think of, let's say, a slinky and a wave moving on a slinky, it can move horizontally or vertically, or some combination of these two. Light can behave in a similar way, where you have, as you see in the slide on the top left, you can see there's light of different polarizations moving towards what we call a polarization filter. And the light is moving both horizontally and vertically in some chaotic mess. And what we do in polarization is, in polarization sensing, is we usually want to measure a particular polarization of light. And so over here you have a polarization filter, which allows only one particular polarization through. This is, for example, how polarization sunglasses work. They cut down the intensity, things get darker because only one polarization gets through, and sunlight tends to shine both polarizations at equal intensities, so you can cut it down by roughly half. And in addition, when you want to sense polarization from an object, you would have to do two measurements, one with a polarization filter in one direction, and then you rotate it 90 degrees to measure both polarizations. In each case, you filter out the other one. There are other kinds of polarization, for example, used in 3D glasses. These use circular polarization, which is the combination of horizontal and vertical polarizations together. That we see in the bottom left. You can see it kind of moves in a corkscrew spiral. Again, this would be like a slinky that's moving up and down and right and left at the same time, doing a kind of circular spiral motion. You can have, again, like a right screw and a left screw, so that's right and left circularly polarized light. And the way this is currently measured is you have two objects you need it in order to measure it. First, a quarter wave plate. What that does is it transforms the circular light into linear light, similar to what we have on the top figure, and that, again, moves through a linear polarizer. So the circular wave is transformed to linear. And then the linear, we select only one polarization of interest. And so again, we would need to take, we need multiple elements in order to measure it. And so these, again, as I said, have been used in 3D sunglasses and regular sunglasses, but they have a lot more applications. Particularly, they can be used to measure this object orientation of different surfaces in an image. And that can be used for characterizing a different compound. Different compounds tend to emit or absorb different polarizations. And it could also be used, as you see in the next slide, in stress analysis. This is a pretty neat example. So when an object, for example, this plastic CD case, is under stress, different polarizations will travel in it at different speeds. So when you compare both polarizations at each point, the intensity and the phase difference between them, you can get a map of the stress in the object at that point. And here you see a basically whole rainbow color scheme of the CD case, which is basically a map of the different stresses in the object. So again, these are currently measured using multiple elements or multiple sensors. And what we want to do is design a metamaterial that can measure all these different properties in a single pixel without having to take multiple images or multiple orientations or having any moving parts. So the metamaterial or metasurface we designed here is shown here in the left figure. You see that, again, this is a picture of a unit cell. So this is a metamaterial, and it has a theoretically infinite array of these unit cells. So just think of duplicates of this unit cell going to the left and right and up and down and infinitely. Of course, a realistic sensor would be finite, but the general properties, these are usually large enough that we can approximate it in simulation as infinite. And in this unit cell, we have three different cavities. So the one that Dr. Lansey presented had two unit cells, two meta-atoms or cavities in each unit cell, and this one has three. The reason for this is his metasurface was interested in measuring two different frequencies, whereas over here we're trying to look at A, polarization, which is different, and there are, instead of two properties, there are three properties that we need to control. The strength of each polarization, right, so how vertical and how horizontal it is, and also the delay between them. Which, for example, when vertical is at maximum, the horizontal could be at the minimum or at its maximum or some other point. Right? These are differences between elliptical and circular and linear polarization, is that delay between them. So, so we have three properties we need to measure. In order to get that, we need to use three different cavities to kind of sample the infinite radiation in three different ways. On the left side, we have two slit-like cavities and one L-shaped cavity. So the slit-like cavities, they couple directly into and absorb the X and Y polarizations, meaning just vertical or horizontal. And the L cavity absorbs a mixture, or the diagonal polarization. And they also couple to each other. So absorption in one is connected to absorption in the others. And when you have these three cavities coupling to the radiation that's incident on it and to each other, you end up getting the ability to determine what the original phase was. So how do we go about designing this thing? So over here we see what we did was we simulated each individual cavity in an infinite array by itself. In order to do this, we did this in order to be able to design each cavity to resonate at the same frequency. So again, in contrast to what was presented earlier, over there we wanted two cavities that resonate at different frequencies, different colors, as it were, in order to split different colors. But right here, we're not interested in splitting the color. We're interested in splitting the polarization of a single color. So it's the same color that has multiple properties in its polarization. So we needed to ensure that each cavity resonates at the same frequency or color. So over here, we see a simulation, which was done in, which is what we do here in the EM lab, computational electromagnetics. We had to simulate the absorption of each cavity and ensure that they absorb at the same resonance, at the same frequency rather, which is what we see on this plot. So here we see the absorption, the blue is the slit, and the purple is the L cavity, and they both have maximums at the same frequency, so they're both going to interact most strongly at the same color. And over here we have, we simulated the complete unit cell, which again is really an infinite array of these things, but we're showing only for a particular unit cell, where we have all three cavity types in the unit cell, and we're sending in a light of particular polarization, and we're looking at the absorption in each cavity as well as the total. Again, the blue absorption curve comes from the blue cavity, and red-red, orange-orange, etc. And what we have in this plot is, and this is a particular case where we send in light where both the vertical and horizontal polarizations have the same strength, so the same amount of power is in each one. And what we're changing is, we're changing that delay between them. So that's what the phase axis is. At zero, it's linearly polarized. That means they're both in phase, so they both have a maximum at the same time, and they both have a minimum at the same time. And as we move along, that time, that delay changes and shifts, and we get moving eventually at 90 to circular polarization, and then it moves back to linear, back to circular, and all the way in the right, it's again a linear polarization. So that's the parameter we're changing, and we're looking at the absorption in each cavity as we change that parameter, and what we see is there's constantly a continuous change in absorption in each of the cavities, and when you look at the ratio of the absorption and you have the total absorption, which is given in green, which is simply the sum of those, you can then determine uniquely what the original phase delay was. And we were also able to show, this has been published, that we can achieve this for different betas or different ratios of intensities between the polarization. And in general, this structure allows us to determine with a single element, a single pixel and sensor, what the initial polarization state of the light is. And again, this can be very useful for different forms of imaging. I'm sure many of you have probably used polarizers in your cameras. That's a thing many people obviously do. And with something like this, you wouldn't need that extra element. The sensor itself would already have built in the ability to measure different polarizations. And now for the summary, I'll give that to Dr. Lansey.
So just to summarize here, we described two different types of photon sorting structures. One is a photon band sorting, which sorts by color, by frequency, where you split an incident electromagnetic radiation both spatially and spectrally on frequency. Once it's split, you can absorb it, you can transmit it, you have control over it. The choice of that depends on your application. You can do enhanced sensing, multispectral imaging, solar energy, and so on. The polarization sensing, so here's one frequency, different polarizations. You replace multiple sensors with a single pixel, and the polarization is uniquely determined by the different absorption in the cavities. And the applications there include, again, imaging and remote compound identification, 3D imaging. And I just would like to add that we have work collaborating with the Biomed Lab here in New York to actually fabricate and verify this polarization splitting approach. And with that, I think we'll turn it back over to Ben if there are any questions.